All right, I think we are live.
Awesome.
I'm so excited.
This is fun.
All right, so firstly, I wanted to start by publicly declaring how proud I am of you. So Alyssa Katzman is one of my good friends and amazing clients. She is also a mom, an incredible mom of two, and a registered psychotherapist who is very, very passionate about children's mental health and body positivity. And she's also the new author of Just As You Are, a children's book speaking specifically about body positivity. So I'm so proud of you.
Thank you.
In this year of COVID, you have published a book.
Thank you. I'm pretty proud too. And I'm very excited to chat about it with you.
I am so excited. Okay. So let's take it back to the beginning.
Sure.
Right. So I've known you quite a while now, right? And you are a fierce mother who is really like really a conscious parent. Right. And I know a lot of the conversations we've had around our own parenting have really been about how do we support our kids to feel their best and live their best.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. And as a fitness professional, it aligns with me as a mother and about how we are as people. Right. I want my clients to always feel their best. And how can we do that first and use for me fitness as the lens of which we do that.
Right.
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 And so for me, when you wrote this book, I was like blown away. I was like, oh my God, we need to talk about this on the podcast. We need to talk about this everywhere because not only am I so proud of you and I just want to like scream from the rooftops about you doing this, but I think that it's such an important conversation in the context of women, in the context of mothers, in the context of how do we support our kids. So tell us a little bit about how you were inspired to write this book.
Sure. So I think that the book sort of has two backgrounds to it. One is my personal one and one is my professional one. So I'll speak first about the personal one, which is that I, as a child and adolescent, and even as a young adult, really struggled with my own distorted thoughts about my body and about eating, and suffered, from some mental health struggles related to that. Mm. And there really wasn't, I found, language and approachable, accessible literature around these topics that didn't pathologize it, that wouldn't make you feel like it was, you know, that you had a problem, rather than just using pro-positive body language. So having struggled on my own, and then I had children, and as you said, I'm a really conscious parent, and part of that is really, I think a lot about the language I use in front of my kids, about everything, about food, about body, about behavior, about religion, I'm really conscious of my language. So having experienced it as a child, and then as a parent, realizing how important it was to use language that promoted body positivity and a healthy relationship with food, I was so inspired. And from a professional lens, because I am a child psychotherapist, I was able to use some of my clinical background, my research background, and my connections with colleagues in the field to really back and support the ideas that I was using. So I, you know, consulted with dietitians and psychologists and some colleagues, and I was able to draw from some of my own clients to know what would have been helpful to have known as a child, what would have been helpful to hear from your parent or your educator when you were struggling, or even not struggling, just developing and wanting to feel good in your own skin.
Yeah, I love all of that. And, you know, just a reminder, and, you know, just to kind of highlight this, you are the co-founder of Social Circle. You're a busy mom of two that have kids that are involved quite a bit with extracurricular. And in the midst of a global pandemic, really, when we were both homeschooling part-time when the world shut down, you wrote this book. So I just want to acknowledge you for that, because that is a huge, huge deal.
Thank you.
But it really speaks to your level of passion to really support moving forward. And I kind of feel like, you know, reading this to my kids, reading this a couple of times through in preparation for this, it was almost like a play-by-play, right? As a fitness professional, and as you know, I run these transformation programs, and we look at fitness, nutrition, and mindset. And the biggest piece, as you know, we've spoken about this a million times, that women struggle with is the mindset piece, is this body positivity, is this whole really conversation around how do we accept ourselves just as we are?
That's right.
And then how can we then choose to say, you know what, maybe I'll eat more vegetables. Maybe I'll move my body out of choice instead of feeling like it's coming from this place of lack or having to be accepted or trying to keep up with the Joneses or whatever it is, right?
Right.
And so this is really a beautiful combination of all of that. So can you speak to kind of the little pieces around nutrition, around movement, around self-acceptance that you really highlight in here?
Yeah, it is. I mean, the book is quite long. I remember when I finished the first draft, I thought, gosh, it might be hard for a kid to sit through it. But it was really, really important to me. And I sort of thought, okay, well, they can do it in chunks. Mom or dad or parent could read it a bit tonight and a bit tomorrow night. But it was really important for me to encapsulate all aspects of it, because it really is so systemic. So the beginning part of the book is like, there's almost three sections to it. The first section is a young girl, you know, maybe around 6 or 7, for the first time she's noticing that her body is changing. So having to sort of create this sense of self and positive body image, and for her parent, because I think that there's two themes, or there's many themes to the book, but there's the Rosie going through her journey
as the child, yeah,
and then there's also the parent-child relationship, which is such a big sub theme, which is the unconditional love a parent would give to a child and a child would feel from their parent. So Rosie looks to her mom almost as a mirror to reflect back. As kids, we look to our parents to narrate our world for us, to reflect back. You were born the way you are, and that is just perfect. There's nothing that you need to change. So, so phase one of the book is her developing this foundation, the sense of self that she is made just right, and there's nothing that needs to change. Stage two, which I think is pretty appropriate for kids that age. Stage two of the book is she's more of like a pre-teen, pre-adolescent, and kids are starting to talk more about food choices. Yeah. And that's a completely separate topic in my mind than the nutrition choices, where even I see my kids, and I've worked with students, say, well, that's healthy and that's unhealthy, good foods, bad foods. Yes. And that's, you know, they start to come to school and talk about, did you bring your healthy food? Did you bring and the dichotomy that people have created. Yes. So in the second chapter of the book, we'll call it, she's learning that there's no such thing as good food and bad food, and how important it is to eat a variety of foods, and not to feel that, if you ate chips, then you have to be good and earn back, the right to have whatever else you're going to eat that day. Mm-hmm. And then the last chapter of the book is where she really is able to internalize the lessons she learned on her own from her mother and pass it on. It's very cross-generational. Yes. So how you were taught to learn about yourself is how you would teach your kids. And she teaches it to her son. And, you know, the idea of having a male protagonist at the end of the book is that boys and girls and many genders struggle with body image and criticism, self-criticism, and criticism from others about their bodies and about eating. So I wanted to look at that peer influence piece and about how, you know, more than one gender is impacted by it, and how, again, how Rosie's mother influenced how Rosie thought of herself, and then how she was able to create a mirror for her son as well.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. And that's what I love. And you know, we're going to speak about a little bit about how you've included almost affirmations in the book. Mm-hmm. But you know, I would love to know from you, what is the biggest challenge that you see being, you know, working in schools, seeing kind of the challenges or the struggles that children have with body positivity? What is the biggest one thing that you're like, that is one of the things that we definitely need to address that we don't even notice enough of?
I think there are many, but I think we could very much look at social media as one of the biggest challenges.
Okay.
Because children are now exposed to images on social media at a frighteningly young age. TikTok, I mean, 7 and 8 year olds are using TikTok. I think younger, and Instagram. And there's so much research now about how Facebook and Instagram sort of ignored the research, or didn't do proper research about how it would impact children's self-confidence and body image. But you know, as a parent, you could be saying to your kid, you're wonderful as you are, and feel good in your skin, and eat variety of food and feel good about it. But then they're gonna go see their friends on social media and see the messages on social media. And to be fully transparent, it's adult educated people who are also giving this information out on social media. So there are a lot of people who are going out there and, you know, talking about making good choices and eating clean. And I know I'm susceptible to it sometimes, and I'm an educated woman, adult. Yeah. So I can imagine.
And an educated psychotherapist. So you actually understand from the mindset perspective, from the psychology perspective, right? The impacts.
Right. And a lot of it is marketing. And I'll kind of perhaps go through my Instagram and be like, oh yeah, I should start. Wait. Yes. So I can't imagine what a 10-year-old gets an ad for, you know, drink this, lose weight.
Yes.
Or seeing an image of someone dancing on TikTok and think, well, my body doesn't look like that.
Right.
How detrimental that could be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and I was going to ask you the same question for what can we do as parents, but I think it's exactly that, because I think that those struggles that we inherently learn as children, they carry on, right? Like most all of my clients struggle with some level of body image, body shame, where they think they should be what they think they shouldn't do. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, part of the mindset piece that I work on is really looking at how can we shift those conversations? How can we find new mantras that actually change the patterns of the self-deprecating, the self-punishment, the using food as a reward, like the whole thing that really a lot of the fitness industry, unfortunately, still pushes.
That's right.
Right. They prey on that diet mentality, that diet culture. And as you know, when I was on the Global Morning Show, we spoke about body positivity.
Yeah.
Right. And how are these things, different facets of like how we can support ourselves just feeling better.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
And that social media piece is one of the things that you're right. It's almost under the radar.
It is. It's hard. And, you know, parents say to me, well, what can I do? Like, should I take away their phone or should we not, you know, allow them? And I think, unfortunately, that's not reality. I don't think we can say to our kids, you're not allowed at a certain age, of course, to be on social media at all, because I think that's where the world is moving even more so. So I think as parents, we just have to work double hard on counteracting it at home and, you know, keeping the lines of communication open. Like, guys, guess what I saw on my Instagram today? I saw this ridiculous thing about and share it with them, right? Because I talk about this a lot, but it's role modeling in your own life. So it's saying, I saw this, I reminded myself, well, that's not how I feel and that's not important. And so I did this and this. And then when they're watching you, for example, like I work out with Catherine and my kids know when I talk about it, I talk about getting strong. I talk about doing things for myself. I never say, guys, I'm going to work out because I ate a chocolate cake, right? Or guys, I'm going to work out to lose weight. We talk about all this stuff. How can you reconcile working out, but it's not about your appearance?
Yes.
And why it's so much more than that.
100%.
So talking about working out to build strength and not, again, it's walking the walk even more so than talking the talk.
Right.
Yeah.
And that leading by example piece of really recognizing what is available when you start investing in yourself, taking care of yourself, is I think the biggest piece that we can really share with not only our children, but our partners, those around us, right? Yeah. Because when that doesn't become the driving force about, you know, we need to show up a certain way,
right,
then it really makes a huge difference in our own satisfaction, right? Our own mental health, which I know you're a huge, huge advocate of, right?
Yeah.
So let me ask you this. So one of the things that I do with my clients is with the mindset piece, really trying to shift the way that we see ourselves and the way that we move through life, right? Mm-hmm. Not everyone's going to take my program, right? And even when parents read this book, it's one thing to be able to model for our children. It's another thing to be able to heal those personal wounds as adults, as parents, right? So I'm going to plant the seed in your ear, because when you write the book for parents, but you know, I know that's a much bigger undertaking, but what would you say to parents that are like, okay, that's nice, Alyssa, that I can read this book to my kids, but I really punish myself with putting that food, right? Oftentimes, as you know, our children not only reflect what they see in their friends, but they reflect in what they see in us.
For sure.
Right?
Yeah.
So how do parents that are actually like, oh my God, I actually do struggle with looking at food as good or bad, or I really do struggle on like thinking that I need to do this in order to make up for that, or that I'm really not happy with the way that I look. How do you support people from a mindset perspective or a psychotherapy conversation to kind of reconcile that?
Yeah, I think it's a huge, huge challenge. I think that, you know, this goes back to the beginning conversation, is that when we were growing up, there wasn't dialogue around this. There wasn't somebody counteracting those diet ads to say you actually don't need to diet. So I think it is very deeply ingrained in a lot of the women of our generation who are raising young kids. And as anyone who knows me knows that I'm a huge proponent of therapy, or it doesn't have to be, you know, clinical therapy, but any type of support that they can get from a life coach, a close friend, advisor, where they're somebody who is pushing back on their shoulds.
Yes.
Right. Yes. So somebody who's questioning them, saying, you know, you, so you say that you shouldn't eat that, or you're saying that you were a bad yesterday. You know, sometimes you require an external voice to change that internal voice and start giving a little bit of pushback. You know, I'm a huge proponent myself of psychotherapy, of someone to say, I know that's your preconceived notion. I know that's your inner dialogue talking. Can we look at that a little bit further? But I know that you help so many people, you know, with your background, you're just as effective in saying, I don't know if I agree with what you're saying. Can we think more about that?
Yes. Yeah. No, I love that piece. So let's turn it to back to the book. So I love that you include this little piece about these affirmations for Rosie. Can you share a little bit about that? So affirmations, I think, is such a powerful place, not just like, oh, I'm amazing, oh, I'm this, but really, and I think I've spoken to you about this before. I interviewed Brenda Johnson, who's a she's a hypnotherapist.
Okay, cool.
And also specializes in mindset, right? She's a mindset coach. And she speaks about affirmations as oftentimes our subconscious is not able to actually understand these affirmations, right? Because it almost doesn't acknowledge where we are, right? To say like, I'm beautiful when you feel like you're not, is a huge dissociation, right?
Right.
So she says, using the word something like, I'm the type of person who can learn to love myself. I'm the type of person who can embrace myself. I think affirmations, I use them with my kids, I use them with myself, is such a powerful way to start shifting those self-limiting beliefs, that negative self-talk, even if we don't fully believe it in the beginning, right? So I love how you kind of include these little affirmations throughout the way in the book.
Yeah. And so like I, you know, mentioned before, I think that as children, a lot of the time it's the parent's role, and it doesn't have to be biological parent, but whoever, you know, a primary caregiver is, to kind of create, to be a mirror and to create that person's self schema and to be that person who reflects back to them. And I think that you're so right that a lot of the time affirmations are so much more effective when they're not about the result and about the process. Mm-hmm. So I work hard at things. I try my best, not I'm beautiful, I'm smart.
Yes.
Because then then it's so unfulfilling if you're not those things. Goals. Yes. And so Rosie's mother, and then Rosie to her son, her affirmation, and I'm very much inspired. A lot of my work is inspired by Fred Rogers. And at the end of every Mr. Rogers episode, he says, and I'm not going to quote it, but something like, you made today special just by being you. Mm. There's no one in the world like you, and I like you just the way you are.
Yeah.
So I sort of have Rosie's mother and then Rosie translate that, which is, there's nothing you need to change to be more loved and more special. We don't need to do extraordinary things in the world. We don't need to become rocket scientists or win a Nobel Prize. We don't even have to be good at skills like science or baseball to be so worthy of my love, a parent's love, of self-love. Just by being born, you are, you okay?
We got the computer. Yeah. But it's true.
Yeah. And that's, I think that, you know, my parents did raise me like that. Mm-hmm. I'm very fortunate in that my parents, there was nothing I could have done that would have made me feel that I wasn't just okay, just right, loved. I didn't need to change to be loved. And I think that there's really no more important role as a parent 100%. Than to tell your kid, you don't need to change to be loved and to love yourself.
Yeah, that is beautiful. And I love that, like I said, this is literally like a play-by-play to move somebody through. What does it look like when our kids present with these challenges?
Yeah.
And honestly, until I read it, I was like, it's almost like, you understand what people our age have potentially undergone themselves and didn't necessarily have the support in a way that was constructive like this.
For sure. Right? Yeah. I know that I went through each of those phases. I went through the little girl phase of, I think my thighs are a bit bigger than my friends. And then I went through the preteen phase of, I shouldn't eat that. Or my friends told me I shouldn't eat that. And there wasn't really conversation. And I think, to be honest, a lot of my role models who were like my counselors and those people were probably actually worse influences.
Right.
And that's who I was looking to. So I think that as a generation, we're so much more informed now. And I, you know, the reason I really wanted to write a book is that I think that many kids find it much easier to talk about another person's character, not about themselves. So if, you know, my daughter came home, I wouldn't necessarily want to say, like, tell me what you're thinking about your body, and tell me, what did your friend say about food? But suddenly when you can externalize it and make it about Rosie, and like, I wonder how that is impacting Rosie. Mm-hmm. It's much safer to talk about. It's much lighter to talk about. Yes. Like, as like the book, even though it's addressing serious topics, it's not a serious book. Yes. Like, I don't think kids read it and be like, Mom, I don't have any problems.
Right.
The idea is that like every child could read this book and be like, wow, I just learned something really interesting.
Yeah. So as you know, I'm very much about daily practices, right? How can we insert these things to take care of ourselves consistently, right? What is the one thing, or how do we keep these dialogues alive, not only for ourselves as healing parents, perhaps, right? But for our kids as they transition through these years, right? Mm-hmm. Like, truthfully, I try to model really well for both my kids, but I've never explicitly had the conversations around their body. Like, we talk about nutrition in a very positive light, very similar to this actually, mm-hmm. right? But what, like, how do you, because truthfully, if you don't start thinking about these things, it falls under the wayside.
Right.
And all of a sudden you wind up with kids that are struggling potentially with eating disorders in their teenage years, or yourself, that you're like falling off the rail because you're in this place of like this push pull, right? What would you say about that?
Yeah, I think that, I know it's really hard right now because especially after, I'm not going to call it post COVID, but post lockdown, kids are really busy with programs. They're diving back into after school programs, but I really encourage, and I know that I follow this, I really feel it's important for families to have regroup time. Mm. And so like my family, the four of us, we try to eat dinner almost every night together. And I know it's really challenging for people in lots of different extracurriculars. So maybe it can be a bedtime routine, or it can be a breakfast, like somewhere where there's a day-to-day or every other day, if it's more manageable, time to reconnect and talk.
Yes.
And they're really gentle, subtle ways of bringing up topics where you can kind of talk through what happened throughout the day and struggles that, and a lot of the time it helps when you talk about yourself.
Yes.
Not saying like, guys, what happened to you today? But oftentimes we'll go around the dinner table and I'll share something that I struggled with today or that day. And it'll sort of open up a dialogue and open communication. And there are days where my kids are like, Mom, stop it. We just want to eat. But they sort of have come to expect this day-to-day check-in. We sometimes play games around it. We roll a dice.
You're amazing. Yes.
not always. Sometimes I also am like, oh, I just want to eat.
Yes.
But we sometimes, you know, we'll roll a dice or play a game where it's sort of, it doesn't have to be, you know, only about, of course, body image, but anything that, I hope that one day it gets to be about something related to friends. I hope that one day my kids are open enough to be like, today something happened because someone offered me something and I didn't feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. But if I've already sort of set the table, no pun intended, that we're going to have conversations regularly, really open dialogues where my husband and I are non-judgmental and really receptive. I think it helps.
Yeah. Can you give us a framework? Like, what are the top three questions or openings? Because here's the truth, right? I have deep conversations with the kids, never at the dinner table, honestly. And probably a lot of people listening to this or watching this are probably the same.
Right.
I just want to eat. I just want to have some quiet. I just want to get through dinner and then I can wrap up my day. Right. Yeah. But I know that you're so mindful and intentional about doing this with your kids.
Yeah.
What are the three questions that you use as kind of the baseline to open up these conversations?
Right. So we actually have like six questions that we often answer.
Tell them all. I love it.
So we'll say something like, something positive that happened to me today. Cause I think it's often the kids come home and they need to vent. So they focus on the negative.
Yes.
So they can talk about something negative, but also something positive that happened, something that they did kind today, something that they struggled with today, something that they learned today, something that they're grateful for.
Okay.
There's a couple more. And I think that they don't have to be the same every night. Mm-hmm. I think that you could do like, that's why I like rolling the dice. Cause it's hard to go through six questions every night, but you can just maybe choose one or two, that sort of just open, like I said, like open the lines of communication and just sort of allow you to reflect on your day a little bit. And it definitely doesn't have to be at the dinner table. Like that just works out in my family's schedule.
Yes.
A lot of people like to do it before bed. A lot of people like to do it first thing in the morning. But yeah, I think some of those are really helpful conversation starters.
I love them so much.
And again, the role modeling piece is so important. So like, yes. I will often go first.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And I'm usually pretty authentic. Like I sometimes have to make it up because I know I want to like access something.
Yes. Yes.
But usually like I can say something pretty genuinely and be like, this was a really big struggle I dealt with today.
I love
it. And that's how I dealt with it. And, you know, I want to keep it brief and not preachy, obviously, because they know, the kids know.
100%.
They know.
They always know. I love that so much because that is exactly it, right? A daily practice that we can put in that really allows courageous conversations and really supports our kids where they are.
And you love, like, even you're better at this than I am. Like, you love like daily affirmation cards. Like you've given me as a present. Like, I think that doesn't necessarily have to be cards, but like any type of ritual where there's like a daily, because you're right. Like there's something, there's like a circuit that happens to the brain that even if you don't believe it at first, the practice of repeating something, that, you know, the biofeedback sort of piece where eventually you're going to feel what you're saying.
Yes.
So, you know, you can do like daily cards or daily looking in the mirror together. There's like lots of fun. Obviously my head's going in a million places, like fun activities and crafts that you could do with your kids to make it really playful.
Yeah, I love that so much. So I look forward to hearing more about maybe what's next in the way of supporting children's mental health. But as a start, this is, as a start and a finish, this is unbelievable.
Thank you.
And I think that, you know, especially we're talking during the holiday season, right? Not necessarily airing the podcast during that time, but this is a beautiful book for the holidays and also all the time, right? You know, one of the things that I love that I've bought my kids a lot are these books by Deepak Chopra that are children's books, books by Wayne Dyer that are children's books, by Miriam Williamson that really speak about self-love, self-acceptance, and that whole modality, more probably on the spiritual side, right?
Yeah.
From those authors.
Yeah.
But this really is, for me, in the same avenue, a full value book of really having a beautiful story that our kids can relate to and really sharing these really powerful lessons, life lessons that they can carry on over a long time. So Alyssa, I'm so proud of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me today. And for Catherine knows this, I'm always thanking her for just being in my life and inspiring me and supporting me. So thank you.
Yeah, I love you. You're welcome. So to get your own copy, the link will be wherever you are watching or listening to this. Make sure you get one for yourself and one for a friend. Spread the news, spread the word, because I think the more that we can do for each other to raise the consciousness and to support each other so that we can all feel our best, we're all better for it.
Agreed.
Yay.